What's going on, guys? David here. I want to apologize. When I was trying to do this before, trying to do a live stream, it didn't save the game, even though I swear to God I did. So I had to do that whole section again. Luckily, without the voices, I just skipped ahead because I knew what I was doing. So we're doing day 3 trial. So this is going to be interesting. Also, I sound a lot clearer, don't I? That's because I got a new microphone, so now you can hear me even more clearly. Not to say my previous mic wasn't clear. I needed something a little bit better, and this microphone will do it. I got the new and improved Wave, but it's the Wave DX. The quality is absolutely amazing, and I have a little pop filter on there. As you can tell, I'm hitting it. And it sounds like I'm in a studio, to be quite honest with you. But anyway, without further ado, let's get right into it. December 27th, 10 a.m., District Court, courtroom number 3. Rubble, 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 why the hell are we still here? Let's get some Wendy's Wumble.
Court is now in session for the trial of Mr. Miles Edgeworth.
The defense is ready, Your Honor.
Very well, apparently the prosecution is also ready.
Who is the judge here anyway?
Mr. Von Karman, your opening statement. Very well, no opening statement, so... Not so fast, Judge. I was taking a meaningful pause before speaking. Right, of course.
A prediction. Today's trial will end in 3 minutes from now.
Rubble, what the hell is he talking about, Rebel?
Order! Order! Mr. Von Karma, what is the meaning of your statement just now?
Bah! Must you question everything? It will be over in 3 minutes. We have no time to waste. I call my witness now.
Right.
I call my witness. My decisive witness to the stand.
Is that mysterious boat shop owner? Yeah, it is.
Witness, state your profession.
I'm the proprietor of the restaurant, the Wet Noodle at Gourd Lake. And I also rent boats.
The night of the incident, you were in the boat rental shop, correct?
Yep, I was.
Please testify.
Wait a second. We still haven't heard who this old guy is.
Objection! Wait a minute. The witness hasn't stated his name yet.
Because I did not ask him, Mr. Wright. Bah! I have predicted this trial will end in 3 minutes. Stop asking trivial questions and cooperate.
He's hiding something. Yeah, right.
The witness will state his name.
I'm not really sure. Yep.
What do you mean?
My memory.
Your Honor, the witness does not remember anything beyond the last several years. Ergo, he cannot recall his own name.
He can't recall, you say?
Yes, but the incident in question took place 3 days ago. He can testify.
Very well. Let's hear this testimony then, shall we, witness?
Yeah, great. Great. Just wonderful. How great. We all know this is Yanni Yogi.
A little water.
It was the night of the 24th, just after midnight. I was in the restaurant where I rent boats as usual. Then I heard a bang. When I looked out the window, I saw a boat just floating on the lake. Then I heard another bang. Just about then, the boat comes back to shore and a man walks by my window.
Very well. I'd like to begin the cross-examination.
There is nothing to question in my witness's testimony. Ergo, no need for cross-examination. Besides,
There are only 10 seconds left before our 3 minutes are up. Judge, your verdict now. Yes.
Hey, Lightning Shot, what's up?
Mr. Wright?
Cross-examine. What do you think we are? What are you saying? Of course I'll cross-examine the witness.
Very well. You may begin. Roar! Excuse me, Mr. Von Karma? 3 minutes just passed.
Who cares about the stupid prediction?
I see. Well, then let's just take our time. You may cross-examine the witness.
Also, I got a new microphone, Lightning Shot. I was doing a lot of testing for the last couple of days and making sure the audio levels are good. And I gotta say, I'm sounding pretty damn good. It was the night of the 24th, just after midnight. Okay. It was in the restaurant. No. I heard a bang. When I looked out the window, I saw a boat just floating on the lake. Okay. Was there someone in the boat?
It was pretty far out there. I couldn't see clearly. Well, I figured there was two men out there, yep.
But you couldn't see them clearly.
Yep, at the time, that is.
At the time? What do you mean by that? So you heard two gunshots total.
Yep.
That's what Lotta said in her testimony yesterday. Just about then, the boat comes back to shore and a man walks by a window. Okay. By your window?
Yep, by my window. Right outside the window of my little shack.
And could you see the man's face?
Well, the fog was pretty darn thick, but he was right there in front of me. I saw him.
This is a rather important detail. Please add it to your testimony.
I have a bad feeling about this.
That man was a defendant. He was saying, I can't believe he's dead.
Hold on a second. Are you sure? Uh-oh.
Dad! Dad's certain, Keith. He said, I can't believe he's dead as he was walking by my tomb.
Hey, okay.
Witness, are you sure the person you saw was Miles Edgeworth?
It was him, that Edgeworth boy!
he fucking fell over.
This sounds like decisive evidence indeed. I see no room for doubt.
Von Karma, he lured me into cross-examining so he could set me up for a fall.
Nick, I don't like the way things are going here. Everyone in the courtroom is glaring at us.
I better act quick or this trial's going to be over. Raise an objection. Your Honor, we proved in yesterday's trial that it could not have been Edgeworth who... We proved in yesterday's trial that it could not have been Edgeworth who fired that gun.
Mr. Wright, are you referring to the fingerprints from Edgeworth's right hand found on the gun and the photographs showing a man firing with his left hand?
Exactly.
That is easily explainable. He could have wiped his prints after he fired. You are ignoring the truth of the matter here. Everything in this witness's testimony is true.
The judge was lost in thought. What should I do? Raise objection again. Objection. Your Honor, this witness claims that Edgeworth said, I can't believe he's dead, but his word is all we have. If he were telling a lie...
Mr. Wright, in a court of law, the evidence tells all. Apparently, you have yet to realize even this basic fact. If you say his testimony is a lie, show us proof.
Nick, do we have evidence? It's no good. There's nothing I can do. Are you sure? To be honest, I don't know what to do anymore. Please... Can you hear me, sis? Please. We need your help. Nick needs you.
3 minutes was perhaps too high an expectation. However, 15 minutes isn't bad. This must be a new record.
What the fuck? What an asshole.
Enough. The witness may leave the stand.
He's freaking sleeping on the fucking floor.
This court sees no reason to further prolong the trial, nor is there any need for more time to decide the case against the defendant. This case is extremely clear. I see no room for a misinterpretation of the facts.
But what? No!
This court finds the defendant, Mr. Miles Edgeworth, guilty.
Oh, no!
The accused will surrender to the court immediately, to be held pending trial at the higher court within a month from today's date. That is all. The court is adjourned until the next following Christmas.
Wait! Huh?
Oh? Who was that just now?
Me! Me who? Huh? What the... Larry!
What are you doing here?
Listen, you gotta listen to me. I was there in the park the night of the murder. I wasn't sure about it until just yesterday. But today I remembered it.
Remembered what?
The gunshot. I heard it too. Rebel, what the hell is he doing back here, Rebel?
Order. What is the meaning of this? The verdict has been decided. I call for adjournment. One moment, Mr. Von Karma. So, you say you heard a gunshot?
Yeah, I did. A gunshot that right. Not right. That night, I was sitting here in the audience listening to the testimony. Then I realized something he said was different from what I remember. Anyhow, I can't just sit here and let you call Edgy a murderer. It's just not right. I'll testify. Let me testify. Rubble. I don't know anymore, Rubble.
Order. Well, this is the first time something has happened like this in my court. I'm not quite sure how to proceed. Judge, you've already given your decision. The trial is over.
Nick, this is it. Larry's given us one final chance at this. She's right. If only it wasn't Larry, he couldn't make things even worse. Mr. Edgeworth was just declared guilty, Nick. It doesn't get any worse. You're right. Okay. Your Honor, if there is another witness, it is our duty to hear him speak. Right here, right now.
A waste of time. The verdict cannot be overturned. Allow me to speak my opinion. In all court proceedings, it is our duty to prevent an inaccurate verdict. In order to make sure no mistake has been made, every witness should be heard.
What is this?
I withdraw my previous verdict of guilty.
What the hell? Judge, you can't do that, Rebel.
Mr. Von Karma, I order you to call this new witness to testify. Now.
What?
Oh, he's even crazy. Like, what?
The court will adjourn for a 5-minute recess. After that, we will hear this new witness. Court is adjourned.
Well, that could have gone better. Whew, that was too close. Sorry to keep you on the edge of your seat like that, Edgeworth. I've seen worse. Yeah, right, Edgeworth, you're sweating bullets. I just wonder what Larry plans to say in there. Larry was at the lake that night? Yes. He said he went looking for the Steel Samurai balloon that flew into the lake. Oh, right. And he found the balloon in the air tank that night. Yeah. Hey, Edgeworth.
Huh? You say something right?
Yeah, a lot of things. You seem out of it. What's wrong?
It's nothing.
Mr. Edgeworth, there's something I've been meaning to ask you. What's that? Why are your fingerprints on the murder weapon? Good question. Oh. When he fell into the lake, I went into a daze. I couldn't understand what happened. I couldn't think straight. Then I saw the pistol lying on the floor of the boat in front of me. I picked it up without thinking. I didn't have a reason, really. Just picked it up? I see. Right? Yeah? This might be our chance. Our chance?
Von Karma has only ever run perfect trials. Perfect trials? Perfectly prepared witnesses, perfectly complete evidence. That's the secret to his success. This is the first time he's ever had to deal with something unexpected. He has to let someone he hasn't even talked to testify before the court. And that someone is Larry. What are you getting at? It's likely his testimony will be full of holes, right? That's right, Nick. No 10-minute trial this time. We'll milk this one for all it's worth. Hey, it was 15 minutes. 15! Everything's on Larry now. Yeah. So this gives us a chance. Larry's testimony would be like Swiss cheese. No pun intended. Rubble.
Court is now back in session. Witness, please testify to the court about everything that you saw on the night of December 24th.
Right, leave it to me! Please, Larry, don't mess this one up. I hate to admit it, but you're our only chance. Our last chance. Von Karma didn't even have time to prep his witness. I just hope Edgeworth is right about this being on our big break. I mean, makes sense, since technically he's a witness that just came out of the frickin' blue. That night, I was out on the boat. I was out in a boat on the lake. Yeah. I was looking for something, and I found it. So I quietly slipped the boat back in at the rental shop dock. Then, just as I was thinking about going home, I heard this bang. I looked out over the lake, but I didn't see a boat. So after I heard that single gunshot, I went home. Single gunshot?
That was an unusually vague testimony, even for this court. In any case, Mr. Wright, you may begin your cross-examination.
Yes, Your Honor. What's wrong, Nick? It's Larry. I have no idea what he's going to say if I press him. I'm a little scared. Well, we've come this far. There's no way to go but forward, Nick. You're right about that. Let's go. I'm actually going to put a save here. Looking for something and I found it. This is irrelevant. So I quietly slipped the boat back at the rental shop. Bang. Where did the sound come from? Yeah, well, I wasn't too sure about that. I looked around, you know.
Did you look at the lake?
Yeah, I looked. Looked at over the lake, but I didn't see a boat. So after I heard that single gunshot, it's this testimony right here. Because both the boat caretaker, which we all know is Yanny Yogi, and Lada has stated that they heard there were two gunshots. Wait a sec, Larry. What? You only heard one bang? You're sure? That's what I said. But Miss Lada Hart testified yesterday that she heard two bangs. And the old man just now said the same thing. They both heard two gunshots that night. Huh? Were you even listening? Were you paying attention at all to what they said? Yo, Nick, please! Huh? You know, something's been bothering me. I'm a witness, see? I'm like a customer here. So you gotta treat me nice and stuff, okay? I don't think that's how that works.
Mr. Butts?
What?
You only heard one gunshot? Are you sure?
Well, to tell you the truth, I'm not sure. Not sure? How can you not be sure? Yeah, well, I might have missed the other gunshot. I was listening to something else. Something else? My radio, dude, with my headphones. What? What an idiot.
Order, order, and stop that booing.
Oh, they're all saying boo. They're like, boo.
Mr. Butts, you were listening to the radio with your headphones?
Yeah, so what? What, that a crime? I listen to my radio. Everybody listens to the radio. What's the big deal?
Mr. Von Karma, your opinion? Waste of time. I do not accept this witness, nor his shoddy testimony. Well, Mr. Wright, should he continue the testimony?
Continue. Your Honor, please allow the witness to continue his testimony.
Bah! Nothing is more pitiful than a lawyer who doesn't know when he's lost.
Very well, Mr. Butts. Please give your testimony and be sure to include details like your radio.
Right, leave it to me.
I wouldn't if there were any other way out of this, believe me.
It's lonely being alone on Christmas Eve. That's why I was listening to an all-request show on the radio, see? I was listening to it real booming loud, like. But I'm sure I heard that gunshot. I remember exactly what the DJ was saying when I heard it, too. Okay, so it's this statement right here, the last one.
You were listening to your radio at a high volume?
Yeah, what's the big problem? Can't a man listen to his radio in peace? Isn't this a free country?
I truly believe Larry has no idea what the problem here is.
Judge, can you believe a word this witness says? What he heard was probably nothing more than a drum beat from the radio. True enough, it is difficult to believe this testimony.
I don't think so. Wait, Your Honor. The witness said he remembers exactly what the DJ said when he heard the gunshot.
Excuse me, DJ?
An announcer, the guy who says things on the radio. Anyway, what this means is, when he heard the sound, no music was playing. The DJ only talks between songs, so he could have heard the gunshot from the lake. I'd like to cross-examine the witness, Your Honor.
Very well, Mr. Wright.
I can't believe I'm continuing this charade. Charade, whatever you want to call it.
So we're going to press this one. What did she say?
Mr. Wright, please cease these pointless questions. What possible good could knowing what a radio DJ said do us? Indeed, Mr. Von Karma has a point. I'll allow the question only if you see some reason why we should care.
We should care. We should care, Your Honor. Of course we should.
Why?
Well, how do you know if you don't ask, huh?
Fine, very well. Mr. Butts, please testify to the court. What was the radio announcer saying when you heard the gunshot?
Just when she said, hey, it's almost Christmas, I heard the gunshot. Almost Christmas. And this lines up with the gun, because it said it's been shot 3 times. And if we look at the autopsy, shot approximately a meter away. Lotta heard 2 gunshots after midnight. So this contradicts. Larry, are you absolutely sure what you're saying is correct? Huh? What's with the face? You look scary, dude. Yay, if you're trying to scare me, you better know I don't scare that easy.
Is something the matter, Mr. Wright?
Your Honor, did you hear what the witness just said?
The DJ said, hey, it's almost Christmas when he heard the gunshot. Indeed, and
almost Christmas means it wasn't Christmas. Do you realize what this means? When he heard the gunshot, it was still Christmas Eve.
That would seem to be the case, yes.
But that contradicts the 2 testimonies we have heard so far, Your Honor. Both Miss Hart and the old man said it was after midnight when they heard the shots. In other words, when they heard the gunshots, it was clearly Christmas. And if we look, we also have a second photo, which is right here. It was around 11:50 p.m. This is a clear contradiction, Your Honor.
Rubble. He has a point, you guys. Rubble.
Order. What does this mean? The 2 prior witnesses heard gunshots after midnight. However, this witness says he heard a gunshot before midnight. Judge, the answer is simple. The current witness is plainly mistaken. Just look at him. Suspicious.
What?
Well, Mr. Wright, what do you think about Mr. Blutt's claim he heard the gunshot before midnight?
He is right. Larry's not mistaken, Your Honor. He heard that gunshot before midnight.
Intriguing. I'm assuming you have evidence for this wild claim. Show me evidence there was a gunshot before midnight.
Right here. Look at this photograph. This was taken by our witness yesterday, Miss Lotta Hart, with her automatic camera. The timestamp on the photo reads December 24th, 11:50 p.m.
Oh? But there's nothing on the lake in this picture.
Indeed, Your Honor. The real issue here is not why nothing is shown in this photograph. It is why this photograph exists at all.
What do you mean?
Your Honor, this photograph was taken by an automatic camera. That camera was set to go off in response to loud noises.
Oh,
correct. There was a loud noise on the lake at 11:50 p.m. That is why this photograph was taken. In other words, when Larry heard that gunshot, it was most definitely still Christmas Eve.
Indeed, it would seem that is the case. Then, where does that leave us? Miss Hart testifies she heard the gunshots after midnight. Are you claiming she was mistaking?
Not at all, Your Honor. It is a fact that the camera also triggered at 15 minutes after midnight. Your Honor, that night there were two sets of gunshots with a 25-minute pause between them.
Well, I'm so confused now, Rebel.
Why would this be? Don't be fooled, Judge. That camera was set to respond to loud noises.
Yes.
There is no proof that the loud noise at 11:50 was a gunshot. Why the witness could have sneezed, triggering the camera.
Hey, my nose was clear that night, man. Clear.
Well, Mr. Wright, there's no turning back now.
Well, I know I'm right on this one, but let's make a save.
Can you prove that the loud noise at 11:50 p.m. was indeed a gunshot? Please show the court evidence if you have any.
Well, yeah. The gun itself. It was fired three times. This is my evidence.
The murder weapon?
Something about this pistol was bothering me, Your Honor. Both of the witnesses who testified yesterday heard two gunshots. However, the murder weapon was fired three times. When then was the last shot fired? Only now have I realized the truth. That third shot was the shot Larry heard just before midnight. That's right. So that means, now stick with me. When the murder happened, it happened before midnight. Think about it for a second. Why would Edgeworth, technically speaking, if Edgeworth really did kill somebody, where was the body? You know, beforehand. So my guess is here, the actual killer, who I believe is the one who went into the water, because that's what happened. Edgeworth met the killer. The killer set up two fake gunshots, actual gunshots, to like shoot at the lake and to have somebody literally look, which was Lotta Hart at the time, to look at the lake, leaves the gun behind, dives into the water, and then... Yeah, so the real scene of the crime is actually the boat shack. Think about it for a second. If Larry, who is out looking for that stupid air tank for his balloon, and then he takes the boat back around 11:50, that is perfect for when the murder took place. He was right by the boat shack. So that's where the murder took place. Yeah, I can go full in detail. Sorry. Okay, back to it.
That would make sense of the evidence we've seen so far. However, this leaves me wondering exactly what did happen that night on the lake.
Exactly. If this is true, there were two sets of gunshots separated by 25 minutes. One at 11:50, another at 15 minutes after midnight. Why, ask you? Why?
Uh-oh, I better think of something quick. Wait a second. Gunshot separated by 25 minutes?
Ah! What's wrong, Nick? I have it! Huh? Remember the case with the Steel Samurai? Yeah, of course I remember. The murderer in this case had the same idea as the murderer in that case. What do you mean? Maya, yes. If we don't figure this out now, we'll never overturn Edward's guilty verdict. I've got a hunch, and I'm going to run with it. Right, I mean, is this safe? Safe? We've already gotten a guilty verdict. We have nothing to lose. You just watch and let me know if I say anything that sounds fishy, okay? Right, Nick. Your Honor.
Yes, Mr. Wright.
The testimony just now has cleared up this entire case. Rubble, what in the hell is he talking about, Rubble?
What do you mean, Mr. Wright?
So, you finally realized the truth? There can be no other murderer here than Miles Edgeworth himself.
Mm-mm. Wrong, Von Karma. A man was shot that night, but it wasn't Edgeworth who did the shooting.
Listen, rookie. Take a deep breath and consider the facts. At the time of the murder, one boat was on that lake. This was shown by the witness's photograph. The defendant, Edgeworth, and the victim, Robert Hammond, were on that boat. There was a gunshot fired on that boat, and Robert Hammond fell into the lake. The distance of the shooting was 1 meter. It couldn't have been suicide. Well, the guilty party has to be the other man on that boat.
I admit it is hard to imagine any other possibility.
Yes, but this assumes that the victim was shot at 15 minutes after midnight.
What do you mean by that, Mr. Wright?
We have photographic evidence of the time of the shooting. The timestamp on the photo says,
pretty much 12:15, military time. But Larry heard a gunshot 25 minutes before that. Robert Hammond was killed then, 25 minutes before the shot on the lake. That's the only way that Edgeworth could be innocent.
Mr. Wright, are you quite mad? Explain who the two men on the boat are.
Edgeworth and the murderer. Of course, it was Edgeworth and the murderer. After the murderer killed Robert Hammond at 11:50, he assumed the guise of Mr. Hammond and met Edgeworth. Rebel, I'm confused again, Rebel.
What? Are you serious?
Yes, Edgeworth won't tell us why he went to the lake that night. However, I have a hunch. That night, Robert Hammond called Edgeworth to the lake. Now, Edgeworth didn't know Robert Hammond's face that well. That's why he didn't suspect anything when the murderer took Robert Hammond's place.
I'm not sure what to make of all this.
Ludicrous.
Mr. Wright, tell us the name of the murderer, then.
The murderer's name? Right, it's... I don't know, because they haven't told us. Actually, I don't know the murderer's name.
You don't know?
Bah! Again, you waste my time.
I don't know, because he never told us. The murderer is the caretaker of the boat shop, that old man. At 11:50, he was the one who killed Robert Hammond.
The caretaker of the boat shop? Where did he do this? There weren't any boats on the lake then.
Why would he have to go all the way out on the lake just to shoot someone? May I suggest that the real scene of this crime was not on a boat?
What? Well, then where did the murder take place?
Easy. Show the judge where the murder really took place. Easy peasy. The boat shop, right here. Here, of course, the boat shop where he lives. That way he can meet with the victim without anyone seeing.
Do you have proof that the boat shop was the scene of the crime?
Recall Larry's testimony, if you will. That night he was out on the lake in a boat searching for something. He finds it and returns the boat. Then, just as he's starting to head for home, he hears a gunshot. He heard a gunshot, Your Honor, even though he was wearing headphones at the time. In other words, the gunshot was very, very close by. And where would that be if he had just returned a boat?
The boat shop.
Rubble. Okay, I guess it makes sense, Rubble.
Mr. Wright, what happened that night on Gord Lake? Please tell the court from the beginning.
Yes, Your Honor. Nick, are you sure about this? Not really. But I think if I start at the very beginning, and I take it slow, I might just be able to figure this out. That night, the caretaker of the boat shop called Robert Hammond to his shop. Look at this. This is funny. This was around 11:50. That was when the gunshot that Larry heard was fired. After that, the caretaker put on Robert Hammond's coat. He became Robert Hammond. Then, he got in the boat with Edgeworth and went out into the middle of the lake.
Then who fired the pistol of the boat, Mr. Wright?
The boat shop caretaker. Of
course, it was the murderer who shot the pistol. He shot twice, both Miss Edgeworth, on purpose.
Wait a minute.
Yes?
Why would he shoot twice if he didn't mean to hit anyone?
Details, details.
Know this, Mr. Wright. The moment you run out of explanations is the moment you lose. Tell us why the murderer had to fire twice.
To create a witness. I believe he shot twice to create a witness, Your Honor.
To create a witness?
The murderer lifts his pistol and fires one shot. That ensures that anyone who heard the shot would look at the lake. Indeed, Miss Hart did exactly that after hearing the first gunshot. Next, the murderer waits a bit and he fires again. Then, the murderer jumps from the boat himself, leaving the pistol in the boat behind him.
I see. To someone looking from the edge of the lake, it would appear that one of the men in the boat had shot the other.
The murderer didn't know about the automatic camera, of course. That's why he shot twice to draw attention to the boat. Once you realize that, everything else falls into place. The boat shop caretaker swam back to his shop. Then he put Mr. Hammond's wet coat back on the body, and then threw the body into the lake. That is what happened, Your Honor. These are the events that transpired that night on Gord Lake. And everyone's quiet.
Bailiff! Bring out the witness from before! The boat shop caretaker, quickly!
Rebel, where the hell is he, Rebel?
Very well. While we are waiting for the caretaker, I would like to ask the defendant, Miles Edgeworth, a few questions. Mr. Edgeworth, please take the stand. Mr. Edgeworth, you heard what the defense has said.
Mm-hmm. Did you hear us?
Yes. Well, why did you go to the lake that night? What Wright has said was mostly correct. Astonishingly so, actually. Yes, several days ago I received a letter. The letter was signed Robert Hammond. He asked me to come to the boat shop by the lake at midnight on Christmas Eve. He said he had something very important to discuss with me.
Something very important?
I'm sorry, I can't say what it was.
Your Honor, sir.
Bailiff, we are conducting a trial here. I ask that you remain quiet.
The witness has disappeared. He isn't at the boat shop either.
What?
What should I do?
Find him quickly. We cannot allow him to get away.
Oh, no. He's making a run for it.
Mr. Von Karma, your witness has disappeared.
A search warrant has already been issued.
It goes without saying that I cannot declare a verdict under these circumstances. I will extend the trial until tomorrow, the final day allowed. I request that the police department utilize all its forces to find that witness. Am I understood? One more thing. Just who is that boat shop caretaker? I think his identity has become very important to this trial. I want him, and I want to know who he is.
And Von Karma ain't saying anything.
Very well. Court is adjourned.
He's very hesitant of revealing this information to us.
Oh, sorry. A lot of water.
Yay, Nick, you did it.
Yeah, well, at least we got out from under that guilty verdict.
And what about Larry? That was something else. Even Von Karma didn't know what to do with his testimony. Larry really helped us out.
Sure, once I sifted through his unique testimony. Still, he did save us. I just wish our cases weren't so down to the wire all the time.
I know what you mean. Sometimes I feel like it's us on trial instead of our clients.
Hey, Edgeworth.
Mr. Edgeworth?
Did you say something? Don't look so pained. I mean, it looks like you're probably going to get off the hook. You could try to smile just a little. Relax. I'm sorry, but I fear it's not over for me yet. What do you mean?
Right. There's something that's been troubling me for a long time now, and I don't know whether or not to tell you.
Edgeworth?
No. There's so little time left. I want to tell you to get it off my chest, but... I can't make up my mind.
What is this about, Edgeworth?
It's a nightmare I've had. A memory of a crime that I committed.
A crime you committed?
A memory of a murder.
Uh-oh. I think he's referencing the DL6 incident.
That is not good.
Okay, let's actually make sure this is saved this time. I don't know why it didn't save the last time. That was weird. Alright, December 27th to 11 p.m. Back at the Wright & Company law offices. What was Mr. Edgeworth talking about?
A memory of a crime that I committed. A memory of murder.
Do you really think Mr. Edgeworth killed? I don't believe it. Not Edgeworth. Some painful memory has been troubling him recently, but he never takes someone's life. Never.
Nick.
Yo, how's everyone doing? What do you think of my performance today? I had him swimming in the aisles, huh, Maya?
Swooning? Me?
Oh, yes. I do remember feeling faint.
Right on. Tell me the truth. It was like love at first sight, right? Right, Nick?
Uh-huh. Me? Well, maybe my heart skipped a beat or two.
I think you do better than that.
Come on. I saved Edgeworth in there, dude. Edgy. You guys should be bowing before me. Yeah. Bow before your hero.
To be fair, he did save us. Even though it's all over the damn place. Today's trial.
Larry, you really helped out in the trial today.
You did. If you weren't there, Larry, I'm sure Mr. Edgeworth would have been found guilty.
But seriously, Nick, that boat shop character guy is pretty suspicious. But AJ ain't off the hook yet.
Way to spoil the mood, Larry.
Hey, I'm just a guy sitting in the audience, you know? But from where I was sitting, Edgy seemed pretty edgy.
Uh-huh.
I mean, can you really know he's telling the truth about that night?
Nick?
I don't know. But what I do know is, I'm going to believe in you two until the end.
Us two?
Edgeworth and who else? You mean me, right?
Nah, he means me, right, Nick?
Yeah, you, Larry.
Not me?
But why you, Larry?
Huh?
Actually, yeah. Why me, Nick?
Enough of the silent treatment.
Nick, why do you trust Mr. Edgeworth so much? I mean, he's changed recently, true, but when we first met him, he was kind of a jerk, don't you think?
You didn't know him back then. Back when he wanted to become a defense attorney.
Wait, was that when you two were classmates?
Yes, in grade school. They saved me, Miles and Larry. They saved me and I'll never forget it. That's why I became a defense attorney, you know?
What? Hey, Larry, what's he talking about?
Huh? Sorry, I kind of forgot.
Okay, Nick, out with it. I'm going to hear the story today, and that's final.
Okay. It's kind of a long story, so hang in there. It was the very end of third grade. I was on trial. A class trial.
A class trial?
Finally, we're talking about it. You remember, Larry? Spring, end of third grade? A kid in our class got his lunch money stolen.
Lunch money?
Our school was really small. Every month, kids would bring in an envelope with money for lunch from home.
Huh, I see.
Anyway, this kid's envelope disappeared with $38 still inside.
Oh, yeah. Now that you mention it, I do remember that.
I can see why you forget, though. You were out of school that day. Anyway, the envelope had been stolen during PE class. I was coming down with a cold, so I skipped PE that day. I was the only one not in class. So they thought you did it? Yeah, the kids in class said I should be put on trial. Trial? So the next day we held a classroom trial with me as a defendant. Look at this. This is crazy. They actually did an actual trial in class. I didn't do it. Guilty. He did it. Guilty. It was you. Thief. Get the money back. You're such a meanie. No one play with him. Just admit it. You did it. You can't hide the truth. Tell us the truth. We're not going to play with you anymore. Yeah, and no bar in my race. You shouldn't be allowed in the relays. We're on the library committee. Give me back my 50 cents I loaned. Hey, did you rob that bank the other day? Now, Phoenix, you know you shouldn't steal people's money. It's not right. In the end, even the teacher thought I'd done it. Go over and apologize, Phoenix. I didn't know what was happening. I was so sad. I couldn't stop crying. Everyone was staring at me like I'd done it. I tried to apologize. I went to where the boy whose money had been stolen was sitting. That's when it happened. Objection. He shouldn't have to apologize. The only thing that belongs in a trial is evidence. Anything else has no place. You should all be ashamed. Amateurs. Miles? Oh my god! It's Miles! Doing an actual pose like Phoenix would do. It wasn't you who stole my money, was it? No. Then you shouldn't apologize. Everyone's been shouting you did it, but no one has any proof. That is why, Your Honor, this boy is innocent. Miles, it was your money that was stolen. Yeah, he did it. He's the one. We don't need proof. Make him say he's sorry. Why don't y'all just shut up? It's Larry. This is always how it is. Everybody ganging up and picking on one person. Just think how he feels. He said he didn't do it, so he didn't do it. Wow. Very well. I will replace the money myself. This class trial is over. That's how it happened. After that, the three of us were the best of friends.
Wow, I had no idea.
Yeah, I had no idea either. I mean, I forgot. What a dick. That's when I learned what it meant to be alone. Totally alone without a friend in the world.
You did a good thing, Larry.
Yeah, well, I was just lucky that I took the day off from school. If I'd been there, they would have thought I've done it. So I took it kind of personally, see? When something smells, it's usually the butts. Anyway, Edgeworth and I talked after that class trial. That's when I heard his father was a defense attorney. I remember his eyes would shine when he'd talk about his father.
I'm going to become a defense attorney just like my father. A famous defense attorney.
Then a few months later, he suddenly transferred to another school.
The DL6 incident.
Right. I'm not sure, but the transfer probably had to do with his father's death.
That's so sad.
It was several years later when I heard Edgeworth's name again. There was an article about him in the newspaper. The headline was something like, Dark Suspicions of a Demon Attorney. Fabricating evidence, manipulating testimonies, covering up facts. The article said he'd do anything to get a guilty verdict. Anything. But why? What happened? I mean, that's not the Edgy I used to know at all. That's what I thought, too. I tried to get in touch with him I don't know how many times. He never replied.
I guess he didn't want to see his old friends.
I couldn't just drop it, though. I wanted to meet him to learn why he had become who he became. That's when I decided.
Wait, you don't mean that's why? That's why he became a defense attorney to meet Edgeworth?
Yep. If I was a defense attorney, I knew he had to meet me whether he wanted to or not, in court. Edgeworth believed in me, and I believe in him. He's in pain, and no one's on his side. I'm the only one who knows the real Edgeworth, and I'm the only one who can help him.
Whoa, Nick. So, is that why you helped me out for free?
Yes. I helped you because I believed in you. Except I don't remember saying I'd do it for free. He did charge him. Ah, Nick. We have to save Mr. Edward if it's the last thing we do, okay? Right. It very well may be. First, there's that rental boat shop caretaker. We need to find out who or what he is. I'd settle for who. I guess I can clean out some of this evidence I no longer need. Okay, let's go. Let's see. Yep, some of the evidence is now gone. Yep, the second bullet and Lotta's testimony is gone. Like the second bullet photo, I mean. All right, let's get going to the detention center. I just realized my phone just vibrated. Oh, what the hell? Detention center, December 27th. Okay. You look as grim as always. Mr. Edgeworth, I heard the story about the class trial.
Class trial? What do you mean?
You don't remember?
No, I don't.
Your lunch money was stolen, wasn't it, in third grade?
Lunch money?
Oh, all right.
Yes, I seem to remember something like that.
Nick, I think you're the only one who really remembers.
Well, it probably only really mattered to me anyway.
Mr. Edgeworth, didn't you know? That trial was the reason Nick became a defense attorney.
Ridiculous. Gee, thanks. That said, it does sound like the kind of thing you would do.
You haven't changed a bit, have you, right?
So simple. To a fault, even.
Well, maybe, yeah, but I think you changed too much, Edgeworth.
Perhaps.
Why prosecute? Hey, Edgeworth, why did you become a prosecutor anyway? You used to look up to your dad. You said you wanted to be a defense attorney, right?
I couldn't let myself deny reality like you.
What do you mean?
My father was taken from me and you want me to defend criminals? I'm sorry, right, but I'm not that good of a person.
One suspect was apprehended in your father's murder, right?
Yes, the man trapped in the elevator with my father. His name was Yanioki. He had to be the shooter, any way you look at it. Yet, he was found innocent. The defense attorney got him off the hook. That would be Robert Hammond.
On that day 15 years ago, the three of us were trapped in that elevator for 5 hours. When we were rescued, we were all suffered oxygen deprivation. I had lost all memory of the murder.
Lost your memory? Even now, I can't recall what happened in that elevator. That was the crux of Yogi's attorney's argument in court. He claimed Yanioki had been not a sound mind due to the oxygen deprivation. Yogi's released due to a lack of evidence. Innocent. That's when I changed my mind. I started to hate defense attorneys.
What's your relationship with Von Karma?
He's my teacher, and a man who deserves respect. I learn everything I know of courtroom techniques from him.
So he's like my sister was to you, Nick.
He's a perfectionist in all things. In court, in his personal life, he is obsessed with doing everything perfectly.
Perfectly, huh?
In all the cases he has taken on, none were left unsolved. And not one suspect was declared innocent. Ever.
But that's...
I know. It's possible some of the suspects were indeed innocent. However, it's impossible for us to accurately determine that in every case. All Von Karma does is his job, to find the suspect guilty perfectly. In any case, it's nigh well impossible to find a weakness in him. Should a weakness appear, he would do everything in his power to make it go away.
Edgeworth? If what you're saying is true, you're headed for a guilty sentence tomorrow.
He's right. Now's no time to praise the enemy, Mr. Edgeworth.
It's a strange situation in which I find myself, I'll admit.
No kidding. What are you showing me that picture for?
No reason.
You know, I was impressed by your deduction in the trial today. Granted, you were at the end of your rope, but still.
Nick, he noticed. Haha. Why wouldn't we present this one?
Nick, no! That's a photo of his father. Don't show him that.
You're right. Now probably isn't a good time to dredge up those memories. What is it?
Nothing.
Huh? So far nothing. Yeah, nothing. Nope. I think we got nothing else we can go on here. We'll come back later.
Hey, pal, long time no see.
Oh, Detective Gumshoe.
Close one today, eh? I got so worked up, I snapped my tie in half.
Sorry about that.
No problem, pal. Thanks to you, we know now who really did it.
You mean the boat shop caretaker?
Look, I'll make you a promise. I'll have that scoundrel in my custody by trial time tomorrow. Come what may, it's my duty to you as a police officer. Now I'm off to catch me a criminal.
Oh, he's gone. Detective Gumshoe sure is active today.
Oh, one other thing.
Eh?
No one can go into the woods today.
The woods? Where a lot of us camping?
The woods are off limits to camping, and apparently the park ranger found out about it. He got pretty mad no one could go in for a while.
I guess Lotta's in a lot of trouble.
Anyway, I'll be seeing you tomorrow.
Okay, so we can't go into the woods today. We can go by the beach, though. Huh? The seal eyesore is missing. Eyesore? Looks like the hot dog stand is closed, too. I guess Larry's too busy worrying about Mr. Edward to show up for work. The boat rental shop. That old caretaker got away.
Yep.
I never imagined he might be the real murderer.
What the hell?
I know that clearing of the throat anywhere.
Hello, what might you be doing here? Out for a walk, hmm? Ah, the days of my youth. Like the scent of fresh lemon, you see.
Mr. Grossberg, this is no time for idle reminiscing. Mr. Edward Strawlin's tomorrow.
That is true, yes. But from what I saw today's trial, Edward should be fine, right?
Well, I'm not so sure about that.
Oh, what do you mean by that?
Well, I'm not sure.
If you find anything out, come by my office at once. I may be able to offer you some assistance.
Thanks. Bye. What do you think Mr. Grossberg was doing here anyway? Who knows? That was pretty random. Alright, we can go to the caretaker shack. Nobody's home.
Hello!
Squawk.
Hey, it's Polly. I wonder where your owner's gone, Polly.
Hello!
Squawk.
I can't believe he run off and leave his poor parrot to fend for herself.
Hello!
Squawk.
Well, we can now examine this, I think. That reminds me, Nick. Polly here knows the number to the safe, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Polly, what's the number to the safe?
1228!
Squawk.
Let's open it, Nick. Come on. I'm sure there isn't any money in there. Aw. But hey, he keeps it locked, right? So there must be something of value in there. I'm not so sure. Okay, Nick, let's see what's in there. I guess there might be a clue or two. The only thing in here is a letter. A letter? Aw, boring. There's no name or signature on this thing. It's handwritten in very precise, clear letters. Get your revenge on Miles Edgeworth? Edgeworth? Nick, why would Mr. Edgeworth's name be on here? How should I know? I'm going to read the whole thing. Get your revenge on Miles Edgeworth. It also says this is your last chance. Now's the time to get revenge on the two men who ruined your life. The rest of the letter goes on to describe the murder plot in detail. How to kill Robert Hammond and frame Edgeworth. Calling Edgeworth out to the lake, getting on the boat, firing twice. This is exactly what I figured out today in court.
It's all here, in perfect detail. What do you think it means, Nick? I don't know, but it looks like these are instructions for that caretaker. When he killed Robert Hammond and called out Edgeworth, he was following instructions. But who could have written that letter? And what does it mean to get revenge on Miles Edgeworth? Look, I don't know, okay? But one thing's for certain. This letter is an amazing clue. It is the best evidence so far. And there's nothing else here. We got evidence now. One day left, Nick. Yeah, I know. Well, no time to waste. Let's get going. Let's go to the Grossberg Law Offices, then. He's out again. When does he work, anyway? Now, don't be harsh. Guess we'll have to come back later. Damn, I thought we could go see him right now. How about the Criminal Affairs Department? Looks like Detective Gumshoe hasn't gotten back yet. Gumshoe? He won't be coming back today. Oh, really? He said there was some guy he had to arrest by tomorrow. The boat shop caretaker. He shouted something about catching him if it's the last thing I do, pal. Good luck, Gumshoe. Maybe the detention center? Edgeworth, see this letter? This came out of the safe in the shack where that boat rental caretaker lives. I see. Revenge? On me?
Who is that old guy anyway?
I don't know. Could he be an innocent defendant you got declared guilty or something? Nice, right. But I don't remember that old man. Not at all.
So he was following this letter then?
Which means there was someone else behind it.
Now it's time to get revenge on the two men who ruined your life.
Two men? Meaning myself and Robert Hammond?
It also says this is your last chance.
Last chance? Wait, maybe he's talking about the statute of limitations on the DL6 incident. Wait, that old man.
What is it? Do you know who he is?
Yogi. Could he be Yogi?
You mean Yogi Bear? Why, where's my pick in the basket?
No, I'm just kidding.
Yogi?
The suspect in the DL6 incident. The one who was found innocent. Yanni Yogi was a court bailiff at the time. We just happened to be in that elevator together 15 years ago. Here comes the earthquake again. The quake was incredibly strong. Before I knew it, everything was dark. We were there for so long, it felt like forever. The air thinned, and the darkness closed in on us in that little box. We became unsettled.
Help, I can't breathe!
Quiet, I said quiet. You're not making this any easier.
I want to get out! Get us out!
Don't shout, you'll just use up more oxygen. That's all I remember. When I came to, I was in a hospital bed, staring up at the ceiling. In court, Yanni Yogi's mental condition was called into question. They claimed the oxygen deprivation and stress had caused temporary insanity. In the end, the claim passed the court, and Yogi was found innocent.
But isn't that strange? This letter tells him to get revenge on Edgeworth. Why would he want to take revenge on you?
Right?
Yeah?
There's something that's been troubling me these last few days. I didn't know whether or not I should tell you.
You mean the nightmare?
Yeah. I already read through this. I'm going to skip that. I think the time has come to tell all. For the last 15 years, I have the same dream almost every night. I wake up in a fearful sweat every time.
What kind of dream?
It's a dream about my father's killing in the dark.
Help! I can't breathe!
Quiet! I said quiet! You're not making this any easier. I want to get out! Help! Get us out! Don't shout. You'll get just use up more oxygen.
I can't breathe. You're using up my air.
What?
Stop breathing my air. I'll stop you. What are you? Stop breathing my air. No, father. He's attacking father.
Then I see the pistol lying by my feet. I don't know if it was evidence from that day in court or the bailiffs. In a daze, I picked it up, the pistol.
Get away! Get away from my father!
And with that scream, I wake. It's a bone-chilling scream. A scream that has rung in my ears for the past 15 years.
But that's just a dream, right? Right?
That thought is the only thing that has kept me sane for the last 15 years. What if I'm wrong? What if it's real? They say that sometimes people shut out memories in self-defense. Maybe it was I who killed my father.
What?
If you think about it that way, this letter makes sense. Get your revenge on Miles Edgeworth. Think about it. Yogi's was really innocent. That's why he wanted revenge against me.
Wait, Edgeworth, you mean...
It was me. I was the true criminal, DL6. I shot my father. This is bad.
What are we going to do, Nick? What can we do?
I don't know. I don't think there's anything we can do, like it or not. There's someone else who knows a lot about the DL6 incident. Maybe...
There is, Nick. There is someone else who knows about DL6.
Mr. Grossberg... Can we finally talk to him? Yes.
Mr. Grossberg.
Hello there. What's wrong? You look troubled.
No kidding. I can't believe you're not.
Am I? Just calm down and tell me what's happened.
It's Mr. Edgeworth. He...
I see. So Edgeworth Trump, he shot his own father.
It's only a dream. Only a dream.
I wonder.
What?
If that's the case, then why do you two look so troubled,
Well...
Also consider this. Yogi quite certainly holds a deep grudge against Miles Edgeworth. So deep he want to frame him for murder. This leads me to surmise that Mr. Edgeworth's dream was not a dream. It was real. As you imagine, Miles Edgeworth threw the pistol to save his father. The pistol fired, and the deed was done.
No, I don't believe it.
Yogi was suspected of murder, and his career as a bailiff was irrevocably wrecked. Thus, he sought revenge on Miles Edgeworth. This was his last chance, of course, with the Statue of Limitations so close.
Yeah, I don't think so. What do you know about Edgeworth's father?
He was a defense attorney without peer. It sounds trite, but it's true. Well, he may have been one peer now that I think about it. You're a mentor, Mia Fey.
My sister?
Gregory Edgeworth was very disapproving of Mr. Von Karma's techniques. That's no surprise. Von Karma is an extreme man. Forged testimonies and evidence are nothing to him. The result, he has a perfect win record in court. To beat him, Gregory Edgeworth tried to call attention to his methods.
And?
He lost. And died in despair, as it were.
I see.
When Gregory Edgeworth was killed, the police called on a spirit medium. That was your mother, Misty Fay.
Yeah.
I am Gregory Edgeworth. I have been killed. The one who shot me was the bailiff, Yanni Yogi. Yet, Yogi was found innocent.
That's when my mother left us. Everyone called her a fraud.
That's right. Everyone thought she was, you see.
Yet, now that I think about it, it seems the one who lied was Gregory Edgeworth's ghost. Gregory Edgeworth must have known who shot him. I don't believe it. So you're saying he falsified his testimony? That Edgeworth's dad lied to protect his son? It's only a possibility, mind you. But a possibility nonetheless. I don't think so. I think he was fooled. But that's just my opinion.
Oh, so this is a letter. It does seem that Yogi was following this letter when he killed Hammond.
But why kill Robert Hammond?
Hammond.
Hammond was a defense attorney, a skilled defense attorney. But he defended clients not for their sake, but for his own.
Huh? His own sake?
He never trusted his clients, that one. The only thing he trusted was his own ability.
But he got his client found innocent, so why should it matter?
Actually, my dear, it's quite different. He won that innocent verdict for no one but himself. Yogi was a free man, but socially he was ruined.
Huh?
You'll understand soon enough. Wait!
What is it?
This letter. I've seen this handwriting somewhere before, a long time ago. Whose handwriting was this? Do you have any idea who wrote this?
I think we know who.
Von Karma.
Could it be Manfred Von Karma?
Von Karma? Why would he have something to do with this?
Well, I'm not sure.
Von Karma. Wait! You're right, my boy! This is Von Karma's handwriting, I'm sure of it! I used to see it all the time on court reports.
What? But that means the one who told Mr. Yogi to kill was...
Correct. Manfred Von Karma himself.
What does this mean, then? Why would Von Karma want to frame Edgeworth?
If it truly was Von Karma who wrote this letter, then he would know the truth. He would know that Miles Edgeworth had accidentally killed his own father. He'll say as much tomorrow in court, I should think. He'll press the point until the court finds Miles Edgeworth guilty.
Oh, no. But how could Von Karma know about Mr. Edgeworth's past like that? Even Mr. Edgeworth thought it was just a nightmare.
That I do not know. Yeah, I do know that Mr. Von Karma is both persistent and a perfectionist. He may be seeking to satisfy a grudge against Gregory Edgeworth by hurting his son.
What do you mean?
It was 15 years ago. Von Karma met Gregory Edgeworth in court, and Von Karma did win. But he didn't make it through the trial unscarred.
What happened in the trial before Edgeworth's dad and Von Karma?
Von Karma got the guilty verdict he wanted. He won the trial. But Gregory Edgeworth accused Von Karma of faulty evidence. And though he lost the trial, Mr. Edgeworth's accusation stood.
Faulty evidence?
It was the only penalty Von Karma has ever received in his career as a prosecutor. Gregory Edgeworth dealt a blow to his perfect trial record.
Wow.
It must have been quite a shock for Von Karma. He took a vacation for several months after that, you see.
A vacation?
Yes, an unusual event for the man. That was the first and the last vacation he's taken in his many years of prosecuting.
Really? He doesn't take vacations? This guy is hardcore. Like go to the sea or to the mountains? Don't tell me he's never been to Europe. You have strange ideas about vacations, Maya.
In any case, that was the only time he took a vacation from work. I believe the penalty upset him quite a lot.
Odd. If he wanted to keep a perfect record so badly, why would he take such a long vacation? What do we do, Nick?
Von Karma is going to bring up DL6, you can bet on...
Oh, I'm reading this wrong. Von Karma's going to bring up DL6. You can bet on it. What if Mr. Edgeworth pleads guilty to DL6?
I won't let him. Yes, Mr. Wright. I hate to say this, but even accidental murder is murder, you know.
I know that. I just believe in Edgeworth's innocence. I can't believe he killed someone.
But Nick, Mr. Edgerman's himself. His father must have lied to protect him from beyond the grave.
I don't care. I know he's not guilty.
Mr. Wright, if you say so, I suppose I could go check again. The police files might hold something of interest.
Mr. Grossberg,
thank you. I can't promise anything. In fact, I think the chances of finding something are slim.
I understand. The police materials. Sounds like we need to make a stop to the police district department, the police department.
There's hardly anyone here. Everyone must be out looking for the old guy, Yogi.
Oh, it's you. I don't think Gumshoe will be coming back today. He's staying out late looking for someone.
Sounds like Detective Gumshoe is pounding the pavement for real. We were wondering if we could have checked out the records room again.
Well, no, I can't have just anyone wandering around in there.
But I guess Mr. Von Karma is in there now anyway.
You can go in as long as he's in there.
Von Karma?
Yes, he just arrived, actually.
Von Karma's in the records room.
Uh-oh.
Nick, let's hurry.
Not good.
Dusty, as always. We were only here just yesterday. I'm sure they just haven't had time to clean. What's wrong, Nick?
Nothing. I was just noticing that he isn't here. Von Karma. But there's something here.
Huh? One of the drawers here is open.
Someone must have been looking in it recently.
The label says unsolved cases evidence.
Unsolved cases.
Nick! The file for DL6. It's completely empty. What?
What are you doing in here?
Von Karma.
You. How do you know my name?
Huh?
Have we met?
What are you saying? We see each other every day, don't we? We're Miles Edgeworth's defense team.
Defense team? I beg your pardon, you see. I really don't remember defense attorneys. They are like bugs to me. Needless things to be crushed.
I can see how this guy was Edgeworth's mentor. The look on this guy is for Dick crazy. Edgeworth.
Mr. Edgeworth is your student, right?
A romanticist who still can't shed that veneer of amateurism. Just like his father, always second rate.
Mr. Von Karma, you had an axe to grind with Mr. Gregory Edgeworth, didn't you?
Me? A grudge against a mere defense attorney? Why?
Because he dealt a blow to your otherwise perfect trial. Trial record, excuse me. So you did. But what I don't get is, why did you take his son under your wing afterwards? The son of your most bitter rival.
That, my dear attorney, is none of your business. Tomorrow will be the last day of this trial. It's been a while since I had a defense attorney last this long. Still, you will lose in the end. Miles Edgeworth will admit his own guilt.
His guilt of 15 years ago, you mean?
You're quite the researcher. If you've done your homework so well, then certainly you must understand. You'd know what Miles Edgeworth will tell the court tomorrow.
We were right.
So Von Karma is going to bring up the DL6 incident in court tomorrow. I have a feeling this is a bad idea to present this, but... Mr. Varkrama, have a look at this. This was you, wasn't it? You instructed Yanni Yogi to commit murder.
Yanni Yogi. How many years has it been since I've heard him called by that name? He's a fool. I told him to burn it after he read it.
So you admit it? You wrote Mr. Yogi this letter?
Yes, my dear defense attorney. Thank you for taking the trouble to bring it to me. You saved me from a lot of needless hassle.
What? Nick, what is that thing?
A stun gun. For self-defense, usually. He has a stun gun on him?
Indeed. 600,000 volts will course through your body like a dog touching an electric fence.
600,000?
Oh, don't worry. People don't die from it, usually. Now give me the letter.
No!
No!
What are you?
Nick, run! Ah! Maya!
Out of my way!
He got us. The letter's gone, of course. And he took the DL-6 evidence. All of it. Back to having no clues. Wait. Maya jumped him first. Maya, is she okay? Maya! Maya, open your eyes!
Basically, this is her, like, lying on the ground, since visual novel.
Maya! The letter. Did he take it?
Huh? Oh, yeah.
Are you okay? I couldn't stop him. I jumped as fast as I could, but one shot from that thing knocked me out cold. I'm useless. I'm no good as a lawyer or a medium. I can't even call my sister. Not even now. When we need her most. I wish I hadn't woken up at all.
Oh, poor Maya.
Maya! Grr, there has to be a way I can help her. I better do something about her self-confidence first.
Hmm?
Maya, she's holding something. What is that? A bullet? DL-6 incident evidence number 7, taken from the heart of Gregory Edgeworth. I remember. Von Karman was holding this when Maya jumped him. Oh shit, she managed to steal a piece of evidence. An eye for an eye, so to speak. Still bears clear ballistic markings. I'll prove it to you, Maya. You're most definitely not useless. I'll prove it to you in court tomorrow.
To be continued.
Alright, let's keep this shit going. We're near the end of this case. Very close to the end.
It's kind of crazy, really. Alright. This is it. Judgment day. For real. Today, things are going to get settled at last. A lot of things.
Ah! What's the big idea? Sorry, Nick. I only touched your shoulder. I guess the shock hasn't worn off on my run-in with the stun gun yesterday. Anyhow, today's the last day of the trial. Good luck, Nick. Yeah, thanks, Maya.
Edgeworth's looking glum as always. I hope Von Karma doesn't push him too hard.
Whoa! What are you doing?
Sorry, I'm sorry. I just thought I'd cheer you up with a pat on the back. Maya, maybe you should go outside and discharge? Right, good idea. Try not to electrocute anyone on your way out.
Ah, pal! What's gone into that girl?
Detective Gumshoe.
Morning, Mr. Edgeworth.
Good morning. How did it go, Detective?
Have no fear. As promised, I have captured our runaway caretaker. I just brought him in. Took all night, pal.
Thanks, Detective Gumshoe. You must be tired.
Actually, after that shock I got on the way in, I feel pretty good.
Yogi says he's forgotten his own name. But that has to be a lie. Why would he want revenge on Edgeworth if he couldn't remember his past? He does remember, and I'm going to prove it.
All right. Let's go.
Rubble, rubble, rubble. I want pizza after all this shit, Rubble.
Court is now in session for the trial of Miles Edgeworth.
The defense is ready, Your Honor.
The prosecution is ready.
Hmm? All right. Very well. We have reached the final day of our proceedings in this trial. I ask that the prosecution submit decisive evidence. Understood.
Come on, don't be awed into silence by every little thing he says.
Very well, Mr. Von Karma. Your opening statement.
Right. Thanks to Detective Gumshoe's efforts, the boat rental shop caretaker has been arrested. In yesterday's trial, the defense asserted that the caretaker was the murderer. However, the caretaker has yet to confirm this. I would like to ask the defense to cross-examine him as much as necessary.
Very well. Please bring the witness into the courtroom.
Oh, he's snoozing again, huh?
Ladies and gentlemen of the court, I believe you all remember our witness. He lives in the boat rental shop on the lake from where he witnessed the incident. In addition, he has currently lost memory of his name and identity.
Witness, why did you run away yesterday?
The witness was not running away, as he will now testify.
I see. Very well, please begin your testimony.
This fucking guy, still playing the act.
I'm really sorry about just leaving yesterday like I did, but I wasn't running away or nothing. I went to buy some food for policy. I figure I got nothing to do with this incident anyhow. I mean, I need one of those modal things, right? And I don't got one. So my testimony yesterday stands as is.
Okay.
Very well. Let's begin the cross-examination, shall we?
He has to know his name. Yanni Yogi, you're Yanni Yogi, and I'm going to prove it. Here we go. Let's press everything. I call what you did running away and not just leaving. You heard Larry's testimony and realized you were in danger.
No. Now, Mr. Wright, there's no need to rush to conclusions. As I said, the witness was not running away. Listen to the testimony.
He sure seems relaxed. In fact, they both do. Von Karma and Yanni Yogi. You're not running away or nothing, huh? Then why did you leave?
He's just about to say why. Is it so hard for you to just quietly listen when someone is talking?
If I sat quietly, Edgeworth would be guilty in 3 minutes. Some food for Polly. Food?
Well, Polly's a bit of a gourmand, you see. She only eats these high-quality bird pellets from France. They only have them in the big pet shop downtown.
But you weren't arrested until this morning. Why didn't you go back to the caretaker shack?
Well, I kind of got lost, you see.
The witness has trouble remembering things sometimes. When the police apprehended him, he was on his way back to the shack.
Yeah, right. Nice try, Von Karma. No one's going to believe that.
I see. So he was lost.
Please, Your Honor, come to your senses. Got nothing to do with this incident? You lost much of your memory, is that correct?
Yeah, seems like it.
Then how can you know that you didn't have anything to do with this incident? Or maybe you're lying about not having your memory, hmm? You know exactly who you are.
The witness has testified quite clearly that he has no memory of who he is. If you claim he's lying, then show the court proof.
How am I supposed to prove what's going on in that old codger's head? That's impossible.
I'm glad you come to your senses, Mr. Wright. Very well, witness. Please continue.
I mean, any one of those motive things, right? I don't got one.
Okay. Press again. How can you say you had no motive? I say you do. You had a grudge against Edgeworth and the victim, Robert Hammond. That's why you took revenge on them, right?
Please don't make me repeat myself, Mr. Wright. This witness has no memory of anything beyond several years ago. He can't hold a grudge. It's impossible.
I have to prove he's lying about his memory. Otherwise, it's going to be the same thing over and over until the trial ends.
Might I say something, Mr. Wright?
Yes. Yes, Your Honor.
You've been saying the same thing now over and over. You've been calling the witness's memory of the past or lack thereof into question.
but does this really have anything to do with the current case?
Of course, Your Honor. The witness has said he has nothing to do with this case and no motive.
Both of these statements are lies!
Order! Order! Mr. Wright, there is a serious problem with your claim. Or are you saying... Are you saying you know who this witness is?
Of course, Your Honor.
Now this is interesting. I would like to know myself, so who is he?
Don't play dumb, Von Karma.
Mr. Wright, please tell us this witness's name.
He's Yanni Yogi. His name is Yanni Yogi, a former court bailiff.
Yogi? That name seems familiar. Oh! Yanni Yogi, from the DL6 incident!
It figures a judge would have heard of it. It was such a famous case.
But what does this mean?
Your Honor, if this man is Mr. Yogi, then he has a clear motive.
Jump into conclusions again, Mr. Wright. This man, this witness, is Yanni Yogi. Fascinating. However, how do you propose to prove this to the court? This is a court of law, as you may recall. You need proof. And allow me to repeat once more that the witness has lost his memory.
This is it. I have to do this now. If I can't prove he's Yogi right here, right now, then I've got nowhere else to go. Nick, how are you going to prove it? How can you prove that he's Yanni Yogi? It's okay. It's actually quite simple. Your Honor, please take this man's fingerprints. Then we'll compare them to the fingerprints on file for Yanni Yogi 15 years ago.
I see. That makes sense.
Huh?
I'm so very, very sorry, Mr. Wright.
Why?
The witness has no fingerprints.
What? What? No fingerprints?
Ah! You see, before I worked as a caretaker, I worked at a chemical plant. I burned my fingers working with the stuff.
What? Yogi, you sneak! You burn your fingerprints off to hide your past.
Well, if the witness has no fingerprints, I guess we will not be able to prove his identity.
No!
Well, what will you do, Mr. Wright? It seems that the case has been decided, no?
No! I know what happened. I know everything. I just can't prove it. But no, I can't let it end like this. I can't lose. There has to be another way.
There is no one who can testify as to who this witness is. No one.
Nick, what are we going to do? I didn't even consider that he might have erased his fingerprints. What do I do?
Well, Mr. Wright, perhaps you'd like to cross-examine his parrot for a little comic relief, hmm?
Yeah, very funny. You're a sore winner with Lawyer Von Karma. Yeah, Von Karma. Wait a second. Cross-examine his parrot? What is it, Nick? No, you're not going to. Your Honor, the defense would like to take Mr. Von Karma up on his proposal.
Take Mr. Von Karma up on my proposal?
Exactly, Your Honor. I would like to cross-examine the witness's pet parrot. Rubble, he's insane, Rubble.
Order. Well, what do you think, Mr. Von Karma? Need you even ask? This is a farce. I object.
Objection. Wait a second. You were the one who suggested I cross-examine the parrot, Von Karma. I have a right to do as you suggested.
Well, if you're so desperate, then please be my guest. Of course, should you go through with this and nothing comes of it, then I hope you're ready for the consequences.
Nick, this is crazy.
Well, still want to go through with your little game?
Yeah, let's go. Let the parrot take the stand. I will cross-examine her, Your Honor.
Oh, this is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard.
Von Karma's rigged every person's testimony, every piece of evidence, except the parrot. She's my last chance. At least, I think so.
Bailiff, bring in the parrot.
We're literally cross-examining a fucking parrot.
That's quite a bird. Please tell us your name. Name! The witness is ignoring me.
It must hurt to be ignored by a bird.
Very well, witness. Who is your honor? Please testify for us.
Oh, God. Took a pop in your neck.
Hello, hello, squawk.
Certainly most concise testimony we've had so far. Very well. Begin your cross-examination.
Right. What are you going to do, Nick?
I don't know. What do we do, Maya? So this is going to be a little tricky.
Hold it. Witness, you can't just say hello and expect us to get anywhere. I want you to testify. Maya, you talk to her. Right, what do I say? Let's see. What's the safe number? Maybe I'll get her to say the number of that safe. Huh, the safe? Why? Let's just try to get her to say anything, okay? Polly, what was the number to the safe in the shack?
1228, 1228.
My, what a reckless parrot. Well, Mr. Wright, you aren't claiming that this number has something to do with the caretaker.
Actually, it does. Actually, it does. That's why I had her say it.
Ridiculous. How can the number to a safe tell us who the caretaker is?
Show us your proof. What could possibly link this number to the caretaker's true identity?
It's the DL6 file. And to make sure, it's the case summary data. Take that.
The DL6 case file? What is this obsession you have with that case?
Mr. Wright, where in this file is something relating to that safe number?
The case summary. It's on the case summary page.
The case summary?
Specifically, the date on which the DL6 incident occurred.
The date of the incident, December 28. Why, that's today's date, 15 years ago.
And the number on that safe is 1228. Ah! He used the date of the DL6 incident as a number for his safe, Your Honor. That's how important that date was to him.
I see. It certainly is an interesting coincidence. People often do set their secret numbers to dates.
Bah! This is not tangible proof. I set my ATM's card number to 0001 because I'm number one. I should probably rename that after I gave that out. This has nothing to do with a date. Nothing.
Indeed. Alone is a little weak for evidence in a murder trial. We will need some other corroborating evidence.
Where am I going to find that? Nick, we're getting closer. One more. If we can just get one more piece of evidence. But what?
Very well, witness. You may continue.
Press this again. And it's going to say the same thing. This time, we've got to have her say, what's her name? Maybe I should get her to say her name? Polly, Polly, what's your name?
Polly, Polly.
Squawk. And the reason why I bring that up, if we look into the suspect data, his fiance's name is Polly Jenkins, who unfortunately committed suicide.
Mr. Wright. I think we've established that this parrot is named Polly. Does this have anything to do with her owner's identity?
Yes. Yes, it does.
Huh? Ha! Fascinating! You claim that the parrot's name will prove her owner's identity? Then show us this proof.
Nick, don't you think you're taking the bluff a little too far? Listen, we're not here to answer the question of who is the caretaker. We're here to prove that he is Yanni Yogi. All we have to do is tie the name Polly to Yogi. Your Honor, the proof that the parrot's name reveals the caretaker's identity is... Present the DL6 case file again.
The DL6 case file?
That's quite a large file you have there. Which page is this proof on, then? Show us or stop wasting our time.
Very well. Mr. Wright, please show us this page. Where in this file is the information connected to this parrot's name?
the suspect data. It's on the suspect data page. This page has all the information about Yanni Yogi. Right after he was arrested, his fiancée committed suicide, see?
Indeed, it does say that, yes.
What was his fiancée's name?
Polly Jenkins. Polly!
Exactly, Your Honor. He wanted to remember the name of his fiancée who had committed suicide. That's why he named his parrot after her.
I see. I guess that is possible. Bah, mere coincidence, that's all. My granddaughter has a dog she calls Phoenix. Well, Mr. Phoenix Wright, does this make you my granddaughter's fiancée?
Are you sure about that, you fucking asshole?
She's only 7 years old. That's enough. I think we've reached a conclusion here. This is a mere coincidence, that's all. True, that is a possibility. However, two coincidences at the same time seems more like a pattern to me. What are you saying? Summon the caretaker of the boat shop. Immediately! Witness, tell us your name. Wait! This witness doesn't remember!
No, it's okay. Whoa, wait a minute, huh?
Huh? Whoa!
I have accomplished what I wanted to do. I'm done. Nick, he looks totally different. This is the real Yogi, I think. Finally! He's been acting feeble to hide his true identity. Acting for 15 years.
Well, let me ask you again. Please state your name for the court.
My name is Yanni Yogi. 15 years ago, I served as a bailiff in this very court. Yep, he doesn't have memory loss.
Order! Order! Yanni Yogi! So was it you who killed Mr. Robert Hammond and tried to frame Miles Edgeworth for his death?
Yes, it was me. I did it. They put me on the witness stand 15 years ago. Robert Hammond, he said I was mentally unsound. He told me it would make me innocent, get me off the hook. So I pretend to have brain damage. I was innocent, really, but he didn't believe me. We won the trial, but I lost everything. I lost my job, my fiancé, my social standing. Then this year, 15 years later, a package arrived. It was a letter and a pistol. The plan was written out in careful detail. It was a plan for me to take my revenge on the people who ruined my life. I didn't care who had sent it. I thought this was my chance after 15 years. This was it. Finally, a chance to have my revenge on Robert Hammond and Miles Edgeworth. I have no regrets.
Wait a moment. Revenge against Miles Edgeworth? What do you mean?
I am not at liberty to speak on that matter. Why don't you ask Mr. Edgeworth yourself? Anyway, I admit it. I was the one who killed Robert Hammond. Wow, he admitted it.
Von Karma, where is Mr. Yogi? Under arrest, Your Honor. I saw no room for error in his confession. Then the defendant, Miles Edgeworth, is innocent. In this case, at least. Very well. Will the defendant please take the stand? There are a few mysteries left unsolved. Still, you are cleared of suspicion for this particular case. So I'd like to pass judgment on the murder of Mr. Robert Hammond. Any objections?
No one. I don't believe it. Why isn't Von Karma saying anything?
Very well. This court finds the defendant, Mr. Miles Edgeworth. Not guilty.
Hey!
That is all. This court is adjourned.
Oh, wait. Miles?
Did someone just say objection?
It wasn't Von Karma. Wait, but that means... No. Edgeworth?
Your Honor, I object to your judgment.
What do you mean?
I am not innocent at all. As we have heard,
Yanny Yogi killed Robert Hammond in revenge. But revenge for what?
Nick, Edgeworth is trying to confess. He's going to say he's guilty. He's going to tell them he was the murderer in the DL6 incident. He's going to tell them he killed his own dad.
Uh-oh, what do I do? Raising objection.
Objection! The judgment has already been passed. I object to Edgeworth's outburst.
Uh-oh.
Didn't something like this happen yesterday, too? I believe a certain witness raised an objection after a guilty verdict was passed.
That would be Larry.
We must hear this new statement. We must hear Miles Edgeworth. He's right. We have a duty to hear Mr. Edgeworth out.
Damn it. For 15 years, I have had a recurring dream. A nightmare. It's only a nightmare. That's what I told myself. But now I know it wasn't a dream. Yanny Yogi wasn't the killer.
You mean in the incident where your father died? From the distance of the shot, it wasn't suicide either.
Everything was as clear as day. The murderer. The criminal in the DL6 incident. It was me.
Your Honor, I confess my guilt. I am guilty for DL6, the statute of limitations of which ends today. The culprit is me.
Rubble, rubble, rubble. What in the hell?
Rubble. Order. Order. This is certainly unexpected. The offended declared innocent is confessing to a different crime. A crime for which the statute of limitations runs out today. I'm not really sure how I should deal with this. Bah. It's obvious. We hold a trial. Right here, right now. We try this man for his crime of 15 years ago.
Rubble, rubble, rubble. This is getting pure insanity, Rubble.
I think I would like to take a 5-minute recess. During this time, I will consider the appropriate course of action to take. Court is adjourned.
Oh, God. Time for the final round. Or in this case, get ready for the next battle, like Tekken style. I'm sorry, Wright. I'm just wasted all of your effort.
Mr. Edgeworth, I just don't believe it, sir. I mean, you kill your dad?
I didn't want to believe it myself, Detective. But it's the truth. I deserve to be punished. Murder is murder, no matter what the circumstances.
This is crazy! Just crazy!
Hmm? Nick? What are you doing?
Huh? Oh. I was just reading through the court record once more. I'm getting my case ready.
Your case for what?
Huh? Isn't it obvious? I'm going to prove that Miles Edgeworth is innocent.
Hmm? What are you talking about, pal? You just admitted to it. He confessed that he did it. In court.
I'm sorry, Edgeworth.
We were going so well without a crash.
Sorry for my random outburst there. I just like
so sick and tired of this fucking Elgato, goddammit.
Yeah. Alright. Wait for it to come back on. Hold on. I swear to God. But I don't believe you're a nightmare.
What?
It's
Mic's back on. That was weird. I don't know why the hell that just happened. And now my freaking, let's see. Yeah, the audio's still not up yet on my, hold on. Freaking ridiculous, man. Here. I think I got it. Hold on a second. Still nothing? No. Maybe. Okay. Properties. Okay, this is not good. Now there's no audio for the game. Although the capture software is on. For some reason, my thing is not working. What the fuck? Okay, hold on a second. Close this again. Start her up. This is crazy. Whoa. There we go. That was weird. All right, zoom back in. All right. I missed a thing of dialogue, but that's okay. The truth is right here in this courtroom. Court record. Man, I apologize. In any case, tighten your belts. The real fight is just beginning. I'll prove you're innocent. Trust me.
Right.
All right, here we go.
Now then, I would like to resume our trial. Judge, Miles Edgeworth has admitted his own guilt. He has confessed his crime. Let us begin by hearing his testimony. Then, though pointless, let the defense do their cross-examining. The statute of limitations on the DL6 runs out today. Though it's unconventional for me, I like to run this one by the book. I see. Does the defense have any objections?
No, Your Honor.
Von Karma, you knew this was going to happen from the very beginning, didn't you?
Very well. Will Miles Edgeworth take the stand? Will the witness state his name and profession?
Miles Edgeworth, I am a prosecuting attorney.
Mr. Edgeworth. 15 years ago, you mistakenly killed your father, Gregory Edgeworth. Is this correct?
It is correct.
Then testify about this matter to the court.
When Edgeworth was telling me about his dream yesterday, I noticed something. One detail didn't quite fit. That will be the key, but only if I can get it to work. Please, please.
Here we go. The DL6 incident.
That day, I had gone to the courtroom to observe one of my father's trials. As we went to leave, an earthquake struck, trapping us in the elevator. My father and Mr. Yogi lost their composure and began to argue. Just then, something heavy fell at my feet. I picked it up and threw it at Mr. Yogi. I wanted them to stop fighting. A moment later, there was a single gunshot, then a scream. It was a terrible scream. I remember it to this day. That's all.
Well then.
And until now you thought this memory was a dream?
We were stuck in the elevator for 5 hours. The oxygen in the elevator ran out, and I lost my memory of the events.
Bah! The same claim Mr. Yogi has made.
Very well. Mr. Wright, your cross-examination, please.
Yes, Your Honor. We're going to complete this case today.
That day, I've gone to the courtroom to serve... Okay, nope.
Hold it. What was it?
A pistol. I assume it was the bailiff, Yanny Yogi's. The safety must have come off when it fell from this holster.
And you picked it up. What happened next?
I picked it up and threw it at Mr. Yogi and wanted them to stop fighting. Did you know it was a pistol when you threw it?
I think I knew. I knew it was dangerous. But the air was getting so thick, I panicked. So you're saying that you threw the pistol at Mr. Yogi?
I was in a daze. Ooh, I kind of burped in between. That was nasty. A single gunshot? The murder weapon was fired twice! A single gunshot? Are you sure about that? Objection! Are you sure you only heard one gunshot?
Yes, I'm sure of that.
I heard the shot and the scream. Then everything faded. I was unconscious until the rescuers came.
I see.
No, Your Honor, unfortunately you don't. Look at this file one more time. This plane contradicts the witness's testimony.
You do enjoy dragging that file out, don't you? I don't accept this evidence unless you can tell us what page it's on. Which page contradicts Miles Edgeworth's testimony?
It's the victim data, the last thing we have not used yet. Look at the victim data in this file. It says it quite plainly, the murder weapon was fired twice. Oh, rubble, it's the same shit that's happened in the previous case. Miles Edgeworth only heard one gunshot, yet the murder weapon was fired twice. Yet the first shot was the accidental firing when the pistol was thrown. So who fired the remaining shot? Exactly.
Was there perhaps another shooter who fired that second shot? Your Honor, as I'm sure you're aware, this incident occurred 15 years ago. The evidence is dated. The pistol did fire twice. However, we do not know when that second shot was fired. It might have been fired the day before the incident. Therefore, there's no proof that the second shot had anything to do with this incident.
What?
I see. You do have a point, Mr. Wright. The murder weapon was fired twice, as we have heard. One of those shots was fired by the defendant, a boy at that time. Do you have any proof that the other shot fired had something to do with this? With the case?
Yes. Your Honor, I think I will be able to show you proof.
What? Impossible! Now, Mr. Von Karma, save your surprise for after you see the evidence. Very well, Mr. Wright, show us your proof. Do you have any evidence that the second firing of the pistol is related to this incident?
Yes, the picture. Look at this photograph. This is a photograph of the scene of the crime 15 years ago.
I can see that the victim lying there is Gregory Edgeworth.
This proves the murder weapon was fired twice at the time of the incident. This photo proves it.
So let me get this straight. This photo proves two shots were fired. Where?
Your Honor, please get a clue. Looks like we're gonna point it out. Show the judge the contradiction. It's right up here. If the shot was fired right here, then what about right here? As should be obvious, the contradiction is here.
I see a bullet hole in the door.
Your Honor, Gregory Edgeworth was killed by a shot from the pistol. Yet there's also a bullet hole in the elevator door. We also know that the murder weapon was fired twice. Thus, someone other than Edgeworth fired that second shot.
Dun, 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 dun. Order! Order! Mr. Wright, what are you driving at?
It's simple, Your Honor. At the time of the incident, two shots were fired. One went into Gregory Edgeworth's heart. The other hit the elevator door. Remember that the defendant lost consciousness after the shot he fired rang out? In conclusion, we must agree that the second shot was fired by someone else.
Mr. Wright, but who could that someone else be?
The murderer, of course.
I knew I should have stepped in before your wild fantasies got out of hand. Mr. Wright, look once more at the DLSIC incident case file. Look closely. Try the case summary page.
The case summary? That's on page one.
Look what is written there. Not a single clue was found on the scene. If the pistol had indeed been fired two times, then the other bullet would have been discovered on the scene.
He does have a point.
Excuse me. That second bullet has never been found. Why? Because the second bullet does not exist. The bullet that claimed Gregory Edgeworth's life was the one fired by his own son. That is the truth of this matter. The whole truth. It was undoubtedly something else that made that bullet hole in the door.
I don't know about you, but you're lying.
Order. I will have order. Mr. Wright has proven one thing to us quite clearly, that the murder weapon was fired twice at the time of the incident. However, as Mr. Von Karma says, the second bullet fired was not found. It is highly likely that the police merely overlooked the second bullet.
So all we have is a single bullet fired. I'm afraid I have to discount the defense's claim.
I praise the judge for his wisdom in this matter.
Gah! How did this happen? I don't believe that the second bullet didn't exist. Was I wrong? Have I been wrong about this whole incident? What are you doing, Nick? Why aren't you raising an objection? I'm sorry, Maya. What? It looks like I was wrong. Nick, if the second bullet wasn't there, then all my conjectures are for nothing. No, but you said you'd do it, Nick. You said you'd get Edgeworth declared innocent. I'm sorry. It's just, when I saw the photograph, I thought that two shots had been fired. I was so certain of it. I thought I won. I thought there was another person to someone else who fired the killing shot. But now, I was wrong to think it could be that simple. This case has stood unsolved for 15 years. Nick!
Well, it seems that we have finally cleared up this incident. Only one bullet was found at the scene of the crime. But that shot was fired by Miles Edgeworth. Precisely. I would like to ask one thing of Miles Edgeworth before passing my verdict. Have you been paying attention to the trial so far?
Yes, Your Honor.
Do you have any objections?
No.
No, I do not. So you killed your father, though that was not your intention.
Yes, I did.
Oh no! He's accepted the guilt.
Very well. The statute of limitations on the murder of Gregory Edgeworth runs out today. Therefore, I must pronounce a verdict on the defendant today, right here.
Right now.
Indeed. Does anyone have any objections?
I've been here before. It's just like my first day in court. There are so many things I know I should be saying, but my mind's gone blank. I can't find the words.
Mr. Wright?
I have an objection.
Objection!
Your Honor! I object!
I don't think so. Mr. Wright, on what grounds do you object?
Ugh! Nick! I don't know, his case is perfect. Oh no! Gah! It must exist. The second bullet. What? What did you just say? Nothing! The second bullet must exist? But where? Someone took it.
It seems waiting is not going to produce us any answers from Mr. Wright.
Wait, Your Honor! The second bullet, it existed.
What? But we just heard proof that it did not exist.
I realize that, Your Honor. I'm really grasping here. It's just someone took it from the scene of the crime. That's what happened.
But who?
The murderer.
The murderer?
Then tell us, just who is this murderer?
I'm still thinking about that one.
So the criminal took the second bullet, but why? First of all, how would they have found it? It's not easy to find a stray bullet, Mr. Wright. Was there some pressing need for the murderer to search for that bullet?
Why would the murderer have spent the time to look for that stray bullet? I haven't got a clue.
What's wrong, Mr. Wright?
Bah, the murderer had no reason to take that bullet. You don't want to admit it, but it's true.
Had to take it.
Had to take it? The murderer? What does that mean?
You're thinking too normal. Think crazy. Don't think why that bullet was taken. Think why that bullet had to be taken.
Mr. Wright?
Yes, Your Honor. I have no idea what I'm doing. Well, the murderer had no intention of taking the bullets from the scene, but the murderer had to take that bullet.
Had to, Mr. Wright? What do you mean?
Well, for instance... For instance what? Maybe the bullet, hit the murderer?
The bullet hit the murderer?
Just saying, for instance. I mean, if it hit you, you would have to take it with you, wouldn't you? It's not like you could perform surgery right there. You know? Well, as crazy as it sounds, Phoenix is thinking on the right track. Think about it. If there was really a second bullet that went off and it hit the murderer, they had no time to perform surgery right there. So they literally took that shot like a champ and then used the pistol and then shot Miles' dad, which is pretty crazy to think about, but it's going to make sense here. Wait a second. I was just talking off the top of my head, but what if that's really what happened?
Let me get this straight. So at the time of the murderer himself was shot, and they left with the second bullet still inside of them, thus leaving only one bullet at the scene of the crime?
Yes, I guess that's how it would work, yes.
But there's a problem with that. The other two people rescued from the elevator, Miles Edward and Yanni Yogi, were both unharmed. So that would mean the murderer came from outside, yes. Rubble, 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 I am ready to lose my mind, rubble.
The two men fight inside the elevator. Trying to stop them, the boy picks up the pistol at his feet and throws it. The pistol discharges and the bullet goes through the elevator door and hits the murderer outside. The boy loses consciousness. Then the murderer opens the elevator door and sees the men inside.
Mr. Wright, you are truly the most unpredictable defense attorney I've ever known. I can tell you're grasping, yet I cannot deny the possibility of what you say. What are you saying? Deny it! Deny it! No one involved with the incident was wounded. There was no murderer.
No one was wounded at the time of the incident. He's right. I can't think of anyone. Hey, Nick.
Huh?
I just thought of something really crazy.
Crazy?
Remember what Mr. Grosser said yesterday?
Gregory Edgeworth dealt a blow to his perfect trial record.
Wow.
It must have been quite a shock for Von Karma. He took a vacation for several months after that, you see. Yes, an unusual event for the man. That was the first and the last vacation he's taken in his many years of prosecuting.
Wait a second. What if Von Karma didn't take that vacation because of shock, but took it because he was injured? Which would mean it could only mean one thing. He was the murderer in the DL6 incident. He was the man who shot Gregory Edgeworth. It was Von Karma. Oh, man.
Something wrong, Mr. Wright? You seem dazed.
No, Your Honor.
Well, you have indicated the possibility that the murderer came from outside. Can you give us the name of your suspect?
And the thing is, that does make sense. He did take a whole, 2 months, I believe, on vacation time. The only time he took vacation, and the last time he did.
Uh-oh. Come out and say it now.
Say it now.
Your Honor, there is a suspect. One lone suspect.
Well, this is certainly interesting news. Very well, Mr. Wright. Who is your suspect?
My hands are shaking.
What?
Von Karma!
Von Karma? Huh?
You mean the Von Karma? The prosecutor? The one standing right over there?
Bah.
You don't object?
I see no need. Why honor this ridiculous outburst with my objection?
Because you took a vacation for several months starting the day after the incident. Yet you pride yourself on a perfect record. Why would you take such a long vacation without any reason?
So you're claiming that I took a vacation to heal my injury from the incident? Fascinating. Prove it. I would have needed surgery, no? Where do I go under the knife at, Mr. Wright? Bring the doctor to operate on me. Have him testify.
Nick, let's find out who his doctor is. It's no use. Edgeworth? I know Von Karma, perhaps too well. He's perfect. He wouldn't leave clues. He probably didn't undergo surgery. That would leave a doctor as a witness. Grr, nobody's that perfect. So what now, Nick? Did Von Karma pull the bullet out by himself? That's insane. No, he couldn't have. You can't just pull bullets out of yourself. Wait. What does that mean? That bullet has to be somewhere, but where? Just think about it. If he's the murderer, he took a vacation, but he couldn't risk, being caught at all. That means that bullet is still lodged in his shoulder. Still to this day.
Well, Mr. Wright, can you produce evidence to prove that I was shot?
Show evidence. All right, Von Karma, I'll prove it. And I'll even use evidence. I know how you like it so much.
What?
The evidence that proves Von Karma was shot is... a metal detector? Von Karma is perfect. He wouldn't risk surgery leaving an evidence trail. So then I ask, where is that bullet now? I think it unlikely that Von Karma performed surgery on himself.
You don't mean...
I do. There is a possibility that the bullet is still inside Von Karma. Rubble, rubble, rubble. Phoenix Wright is insane. Rubble, rubble, rubble.
Is that even possible for all these years?
Well, that's one way to find out. We could use this metal detector. Well, Von Karma, I'm going to run this over you and see what we find. Oh, look at him now. Now he's worried. Now he's really worried.
I refuse.
You refuse? But refusing this means you acknowledge that the bullet is still inside you. Rubble, rubble, rubble. This is getting really absurd, Rubble.
Order, order, order.
Your Honor, the defense requests that we be allowed to use the metal detector.
Judge, I call for a suspension of this trial. This is an invasion of privacy.
The statute of limitations runs out on this case today. It was you who said we had to end it right here, right now.
Enough. I permit the use of the metal detector. Mr. Von Karma, you will submit yourself to testing.
Nick, what does this mean? I don't know, but we have to give it a shot. God damn. Well, I'll be damned. It reacted. Something is inside his right shoulder. The bullet. Mr. Von Karma?
You. It was you. I was afraid this would happen, and so I remained silent. Indeed, there is a bullet in my shoulder. However, it has nothing to do with this incident.
What?
I was shot in the shoulder long before the DL6 incident. I claim that the bullet in my shoulder has no relation to DL6.
Oh, he's just grasping for straws right now.
But Mr. Von Karma, can you prove that?
Prove? No. I have no obligation to prove anything. It is Mr. Wright who must prove something here. not I. Mr. Wright? Well, can you prove it? Can you prove that the bullet in Von Karma's shoulder was from DL6? Of course he can't. You don't have any of the DL6 evidence!
That's because you took it out of the records room yesterday. But funny enough, we have the proof.
With no proof, you cannot convict me of any crime. So sorry, Mr. Wright.
No, I'm the one who's sorry, Mr. Von Karma.
What?
You were close. One day away from freedom. But you see, I have proof.
What?
Who would have thought you would dig your own grave trying to convict Edgeworth? I can link that bullet in your shoulder to the DL6 incident. And here's my final proof. Take that!
That's a bullet? Where did you get that?
This is the bullet used in the DL6 incident. This was taken from the heart of the victim, Mr. Gregory Edgeworth. The bullet is preserved quite nicely with all the ballistic markings intact.
Ballistic markings?
Yeah. That's one way we can prove it. You may recall the term. It came up in the first trial 2 days ago.
Ballistic markings are the fingerprints of a weapon. All bullets fired from the gun are marked with the weapon's unique pattern. By examining the markings, you can tell which weapon fired the bullet. It's quite accurate.
Yep. We have two bullets in our possession. One, the bullet removed from Gregory Edgeworth's heart. The other, Mr. Von Karma, is the bullet buried in your shoulder. We can analyze both bullets. Then, if the markings match, we would know that both bullets had been fired from the same gun. The very same pistol, in other words, the murder weapon that killed Gregory Edgeworth. Mr. Von Karma, you will let us remove the bullet from your shoulder. Then we'll compare the ballistic markings to those on this bullet. And solve this case once and for all. Well, Mr. Von Karma?
That scream. I've heard that scream before. Wait. I know.
Help, I can't breathe. Quiet, I said quiet. You're not making this any easier. Stop breathing my air. I'll stop you. Stop breathing my air. Get away. Get away from my father.
It's that scream I heard in the elevator 15 years ago. Von Karma, it was you who screamed.
Mr. Von Karma.
Edgeworth! Edgeworth! Only you would dare defy me.
So it was you.
You and your father are my curse. Your father shamed me with a penalty on my record. And you, left a scar on my shoulder that would never fade. I'll bury you. I'll bury you with my bare hands. Death! Death!
Man, he's smacking the hell out of his fucking head. 15 years earlier.
Chief Prosecutor, I am sorry.
Von Karma, it's not like you to make this kind of error. I never would have thought that Edgeworth would be the one to catch you. I was careless.
I'm sorry, but you will have to be penalized. I've covered for you in the past, but not this time.
Edgeworth! It was a shock like none I had ever known. Me, penalized. It took hours for me to regain my composure. Suddenly, I find myself in the darkness. I was in the court records room. I must have wandered in there without thinking where I was going. The room was pitch black. The lights must have gone out. I went out into the hall and felt my way to the elevator. I pressed the button, but nothing happened. Then, there was a noise.
And hit him right in the shoulder like that.
I was in pain. A horrible burning pain in my shoulder. Just then, the lights came back on. The elevator door opened before my eyes.
and he picked up the pistol. I saw three people inside, all lying unconscious from oxygen deprivation. Much of my surprise, a pistol lay at my feet. I knew then it was my destiny. Or it was destiny, and he shot him. Shot Miles' dad. In his last moments, Gregory Edgeworth was still unconscious. He died never knowing who had shot him. Later, he spoke through a medium blaming Mr. Yogi. He was fooled. He was the perfect crime. It was the perfect crime. Yeah, that. There you go. Who would have thought that another man would have come to open that elevator door? Judge. What? What are you doing? Do your job. Bring an end to this miserable charade. Now, end it. Very well. There you go. He admitted it. It appears that we have come a very long way to the end of this maze. 15 years later, Mr. Miles Edgeworth. Yes, Your Honor. You were innocent. You are innocent. As you said, it was all a nightmare. Yes, Your Honor. This court finds the defendant, Mr. Miles Edgeworth, not guilty. Yay, again! Pizza party, let's go! That is all. This court is adjourned. Until next Christmas. Okay, that joke is getting old. December 28th, 5:38 p.m. Nick, we did it! Did you see his face? Von Karma looked even paler than usual. He's pretending to be all cool, but inside you crushed him, Nick. Crushed! I gotta say, I'm impressed. It was pretty close, though. I was sure we had it. I know, I was on the verge of tears the whole time, myself. But now it's all just a good memory. So, it's finally over, Edgeworth. Right. Yeah? I'm not sure how to say this. I know. Try thank you. I see. Thank you, right. You're welcome. I think you could have done better than that. Sorry, I'm not good at this sort of thing. You got a lot to learn, Edgeworth. She's got you there.
Whoa! Amazing, pal! You pulled through just like I thought you would! I'll never forget this. I owe you one, pal. And tonight, let's party. Dinner's on me. Yeah, my salary went down a bit this month. But who cares?
See? Mr. Edgeworth, you should take a lesson from Let's start that again, shall we? See, Mr. Edgeworth, you should take a lesson from Detective Gumshoe. That's how you say thank you.
I see. Whoop! I feel foolish.
Don't worry, take it a little at a time. You'll get used to it.
It's been 15 years since I've seen Edward this unguarded.
Hey, y'all!
Lada!
Y'all were great in there!
Thank you.
Yo, Edward, congrats!
Thank y'all very much.
I knew you were innocent from the start, of course. Just look at you, you wouldn't stick your head in the cookie jar even if no one was there.
You were the witness on the first day of the trial, weren't you?
Yeah, well, let bygones be bygones, eh?
Speaking of which, what are you going to do now, Lada?
Who, me? I went back to college. I gave up trying to be an investigative photographer pretty quick.
Really? That's too bad.
Huh? Isn't that the hot dog guy from the park?
Huh?
It's over, Nick. My life is over.
Why the sad face, Larry? What happened now?
Oh, Nick, I'm not long for this world.
You don't look sick.
It's Kianse. She's going to live in Paris. Paris, Nick! She's leaving me behind!
Should have seen that coming.
Yo, Edgy, there you are.
Yes, here I am.
Congrats, Edgy. Here, a little gift from me in celebration.
Celebration? That's unusual for you.
Harry Butts, you come along tonight, too. My treat, pal.
Thanks. Looking forward to it.
Yo, Nick, that's the suit that questioned me.
When he says treat, that's not police talk for prison food, right?
I think you'll be fine, Larry.
Right?
Yeah?
What's up?
That envelope that Larry gave me, it gave me money. It's got money in it.
Well, yeah, that's not strange. People give money away to celebrate sometimes. It's $38, right?
Huh? What a weird amount. I mean, it's not a little, but it's not a lot either.
$38 exactly?
Nick, wasn't that exactly the amount of lunch money that was stolen from Mr. Edgeworth in school?
$38?
No.
No! Larry, it was you?
What are you so surprised about, right?
Huh?
Larry was absent that day from school, right? But that doesn't automatically rule him out as a suspect.
What?
Think back to that day 15 years ago. Larry took the day off, but he was bored, so he came into school anyway. Then he saw the money lying there, and the rest is history.
I never was good at history.
Edgeworth, you didn't know, did you?
I suspected. I just couldn't picture Larry protecting you like he did like that day. Everyone else was saying you did it. The whole class was against you, remember?
Yeah, too well. Right, you may not know this, but we used to have a saying back in school. When something smells, it's usually the butts.
I know.
Really, right? I'm surprised you didn't figure it out.
Well, this sure is an unexpected turn of events, huh?
Edgeworth.
Hmm?
You should have told me!
Now, Nick, it was 15 years ago. Don't you think the statute of limitations has run out, Mr. Edgeworth?
I'd say so, yes.
There you have it.
Urgh.
Where does that leave me? I became a defense attorney because of what you two did.
Well, you have always been something of an insufferable emotionalist.
Yeah, and you get worked up too easily, too.
Death! The death sentence for both of you! Man, if only I had known, I'd have not become a prosecutor.
The same goes for me, only the other way around. For the longest time, I thought that I might have killed my own father. I thought I might be a criminal. I became a prosecutor in part to punish myself. If I had known the truth, I might have become a defense attorney after all.
Edgeworth, want to switch right?
Hey, y'all line up. I'll take a photo.
Hey, photo time. Let's go.
And after that, dinner on me.
Detective Gumshoe took us out on the town that night. We celebrate Edgeworth's newfound freedom, even though Edgeworth himself was still in detention. December 29th, 5:02 a.m. in the morning, Rain Company Law Offices. Super early. Oh, I went a little overboard yesterday. My head hurts. Huh? It's still only 5 in the morning. Maybe I should go back to sleep. Hmm? What's this? A letter? No, it's from Maya.
Good morning, Nick. You were really impressive yesterday. Seeing you, it made me think about what I'm doing here. I'm a spirit medium. In training, of course. I wanted to help Mr. Edgeworth, too. I wanted to help you, but I couldn't. I was useless. So I decided to go back to my training. I'll become a full-fledged spirit medium, for starters. I couldn't say it to your face, so I left this letter. Goodbye, Nick.
She's leaving. Goodbye? What time is it?
God, the first trains for the mountains have already left to the station.
Run! Here we are. We're at the station.
I guess I'm too late.
Hey, Nick? Maya?
So, you're leaving?
Yeah.
It's hard being a spirit medium who can't talk to spirits. And I think you'll do fine without me, Nick. Be good, okay?
Hold it!
Wait! What?
I never could have saved Edgeworth without your help.
Huh?
On the last day of the trial, I heard her. I heard Mia's voice.
You heard my sister?
Yes, only her voice, but still. It was at the very end when I thought we lost everything.
Well, that's my sister for you. Detective Gumshoe helped, and Mr. Grossberg, and even Larry. I'm the only one who couldn't help. I was useless, Nick.
But you were the one who stopped Von Karma, Maya.
Huh? I didn't do anything. All I did was wander around in a daze. Sorry, but I have evidence that you helped. Evidence? Show Maya's evidence to cheer her up. It's the bullet that she took from Von Karma.
Take that!
A bullet? Von Karma was convinced he had taken all the evidence pertaining to DL6. But you were the one who rescued the last piece of evidence we needed. This was the bullet that put an end to Von Karma. And you were the one who gave it to me. Nick. Thanks, Maya. I couldn't have done it without you. I'll be back soon. I'm going to complete my training and come back. Okay, I'll be waiting. Of course you will. You can't run that office by yourself. You're hopeless.
I don't know about that.
Well, that's a weird noise for a freaking train. So this is it. See you soon, Maya. Dun 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 dun. But dun 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 dun. Thanks, Nick. Aw. Dun dun dun. And so my story ends. Time to turn a new page. And say goodbye to the novice defense attorney that I once was. Now a new story begins. With the same old crazy cast of characters.
Ha! Don't think you've graduated, you amateur!
Mr. Wright, perhaps you'd like to rethink that claim.
Yes, Your Honor. Uh-oh, I got a bad feeling about this. Objection! And there you have it. Ace Attorney 1 is done. Pretty short game. Oh, wait a minute.
Hey, pal. Mr. Edgeworth came down to the precinct to wish me a happy new year. Talk about a pleasant surprise.
Whoop! Did that come true?
Then he hung his head low and went right back outside. Kind of like he was embarrassed or something. Strange, huh?
There you go. So we're going to see all the characters that pretty much seen in the game.
Oh, Larry. Oh, no. Huh? Nick? Nah, I haven't seen him lately. Who, me? I've been working at a cheese shop. That Missy's a nice lady, but she's not exactly what you call a cheap date. Huh? Oh, she's in Hawaii right now, yeah. Oh, Larry. When he usually smells, it's the butts.
Oh, right. Yeah, I remember him. I hear he's been busy lately. You know, not to ring my own bell, but I sort of taught him everything he knows. I'm sure he's grateful.
Yeah, sure, sure, Payne, sure.
Phoenix Wright? Ah, the defense attorney from whom I wrote that affidavit for, yes. Oh, you should know I've taken over management of the Great Water Hotel recently. Should you be in the area, please stop by.
Okay, bellboy, whatever.
Oh, it's you, Phoenix Wright. Ah, yes, me as understanding, was he not? I wonder how he's doing, haven't seen him of late. Ah, the days of my youth, like the scent of fresh lemon, you see.
This freaking guy. Oh no.
Phoenix Wright! Is he an actor? Well, I'm not buying it. You can't be a star with a name like Phoenix Wright. Did you know that they're family friendly?
Oh god, I'm not fucking doing that. She keep talking shit. Oh, I don't like voicing her. She's such a pain in the ass to like say that shit so fast.
Oh, I'm pleased to announce the Pink Princess is a hit. I'm sure you owe that Mr. Wright a great deal. Oh, and I'm keeping my face out of the public eye till the show's over. I wouldn't want to ruin any kids' dreams, you know.
Okay, Mr. Powers.
Dun 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 dun. La 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 la.
Oh, I got a letter from Maya the other day. It sounds like she caught a cold standing under a waterfall. I wanted to visit, but didn't have time, so I sent her some Pink Princess trading cards. She said she can't buy them where she is. What kind of place is she living at, anyway?
The spiritual kind.
Oh, this guy. Right? Who's that? You want to talk? Let's talk Pink Princess, all right? But, you know, I snuck into the studio the other day, and I saw her, the one inside the Pink Princess suit. What a dog. It was kind of a shock for a boy of my tender age. Found out that Will Powers is playing Pink Princess. That's pretty damn funny. Yeah, I remember, right? That lawyer guy. Huh, me? I'm in training to become a paranormal photographer. You know, that picture I took of everyone? Well, just behind them, there's a ghost. For real. Now that's their talent. I gotta be famous.
She's gonna be a paranormal photographer. Oh, boy.
Ah, look who it is. Shinji Mikami. So, yes, Shinji Mikami helped and executive produced this game. Hey! And there's our victory. And you see Maya right there. So that means Lada did take the photo. Yeah, all right, Capcom. Thank you very much. Hold it! You thought we were done. Nah, we got one more bonus case. So for those who do not know, when Phoenix Wright 1 originally came out, it came with just these four cases on the Game Boy Advance. However, when the DS came out, they re-released this game, and they made a brand new case to this game, making a total of five cases. And this fifth case is the longest one I've ever seen. One of the longest, in fact. Up there in the third game, in the final case for that as well. It's called Rise from the Ashes. And just like that, I'm going to put a save right here onto save number two. So that's it. So Rise from the Ashes, the last episode, officially, technically, for Phoenix Wright 1. I will be doing this on Friday after Thanksgiving. So, yeah, for those who are sticked around, thank you guys for watching. Please leave a like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell button. And most importantly, to all who I will not see tomorrow, a happy, safe, and fulfilling Thanksgiving, to which I will say thank you to everyone, again, for sticking around for as long as they have, subscribed to this channel for being over God knows how old this whole freaking channel's been, over 12 years, and on my journey to become a voice actor as well. I want to say thank you to everybody who have really been inspiring me to literally get this going, and this fire is never going to die, so... Thanks again for watching, and I will see you guys later. Peace, guys.